Hey, good evening, everybody. It is good to see you all. I see a lot of people that weren't here last week because they have COVID, and I know that there's a lot of people not here this week because they have COVID now, and we'll see them next week. And then that'll be everybody, right? We'll be done? Maybe. We'll see. All right. Hey, it's really good to have you all here tonight. I have one announcement, and one announcement only tonight, and that is youth group this Wednesday has been canceled. So there will be no youth group this Wednesday night. So if you show up here, if your kid shows up here Wednesday evening, the doors will be locked, the lights will be off, and so they'll call you and you can come pick them up. So no youth group this Wednesday. That's the only announcement. I am super excited about tonight. I'm excited about this passage that we're in. I was just talking with Luke. Just that the Gospel of John, I don't know about you guys, but for me, the Gospel of John has taken on, has taken some new depth for me as we've walked through it. I've seen things that I've never seen before. I've had to reevaluate some things that I read into the text before that now, looking at the book in such intensity as we have over the last few months, it's just been really, really rich. On that note, we did get some more of those scripture journals. So if you were one of the people that raised your hand last week that you wanted one of those, they're on the back table. You can go grab that, and then you can have a place to keep your sermon notes and follow along as we teach through the book of John. Would you rise with me, and we will prepare our hearts to worship. Lord Jesus, we are so thankful to be here with you tonight. We are so thankful that you brought us through another week. Lord, for some of us, the week was hard. It was stressful, and so we're bringing a lot of baggage and anxiety into tonight. For some of us, we can't even remember the last week, and we're just here. And for some of us, we have a hard week coming up, and we're having trouble being present tonight because we're thinking about tomorrow morning or this coming week. Lord Jesus, regardless of how we come into tonight, we ask that you would be here, that you would make your presence known. And Lord, that you would work in us to help us be present, to truly worship you, to worship you with our physical being, with our voices, to worship you with our minds as we learn. Lord Jesus, to remember what you've done through us through communion. Lord, help us to be present for all of it. Jesus, work in our hearts tonight. I pray that we would walk out of here challenged, encouraged, lifted up, but mostly, Lord, that we would see you more clearly and we would love you more dearly. We pray all these things in your name, amen.
You guys ready to worship? Sometimes when things are hard, you need like a hug and a comforting listening ear. And sometimes you just need to sing really loud and have fun and remember that God is good. Isn't that true? We're going to do a little both tonight, but we're going to start with the fun. Is that all right? All the introverts are going to have to extrovert just a little extra for this song. Good luck.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Sing it out.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Sing it out. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back.
All right. The Bible says to greet each other with friendliness. We won't talk about kissing with the COVID and everything, but greet each other. Tell someone you're glad they're here. Meet a new person. And in a second, we'll come back for the reading of Scripture.
When I transposed, I used the one on here. This is stupid G sharp. Did not go there. And I did not have the thinking time.
It's all good, dude. Oh. Don't worry about it.
That freaking sucks.
They're supposed to be 10%.
Ladies and gentlemen, am I still on? I'm going to be on soon. Somewhere. Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, now's the time to return to your seats. I didn't mean to get that extroverted. You guys are going too far. All right, my name is Luke, and I've been going to this church for 7 years, six maybe, a little while. And tonight I'll be reading from John chapter 15. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may be more fruitful. Already you are clean because of the word that I've spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. And as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love is no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. And you are my friends, if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant doesn't know what his master is doing. But I've called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, so that you will love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
All right. So, as I said, as Luke just said, we're in John 15. And this, as we've been talking all throughout the Gospel of John, this theme of reframe, right? We're reframing our understanding of Jesus through the eyes of the Apostle John. And again, as I said earlier, as we've walked through this, the Gospel of John has become so rich. Like, so many things that I hadn't ever seen before because of the way that we're walking through it. And so John 15, I think, kind of hits that even harder. I've never fully understood this text, which is a really popular text. And as we get into it, you guys are going to recognize it. And you'll have heard some of these things before. But looking at these 17 verses as they build off of the last two chapters has been really significant for me, and I think it's going to be significant for us tonight as well. Not just looking at a passage, because we tend to do that, right? I'm going to sit down, I'm going to read this passage, I'm going to read this chapter, and I'm just going to take it. And sometimes we do a good job of looking at that particular passage or chapter in its context. And so as we talked about last week, a big part of how biblical interpretation for us needs to work is that immediate context. And then the next step is looking at it in the context of the book that it's a part of. So Galatians, for example, I can't take any part of Galatians and apply a meaning to it that doesn't also fit the greater part of Galatians. Does that make sense? Like, Paul, as he wrote Galatians, didn't go off on a wild hair and write something that only can be interpreted in light of 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Like, I just pulled something out of my head. It doesn't work that way. Right? Paul wrote Galatians to the Galatians. It's one continuous book. So any individual part of Galatians that we see and want to find the meaning for, we're going to do that, hopefully, in light of the entire book of Galatians. Same being true of John. And so looking at these 17 verses in light of what we've been talking about, I think gives it greater clarity. So here we go. John 15 verses 1 through 17. This passage is amazing. It's about a relationship with Jesus. It's about love. It's about good works. Okay, we don't like to talk about good works as much. We like to talk about love and grace and relationship with Jesus. But then when we start talking about works and being cut off and thrown in the fire, like those are the parts we shy away from. It's about community. And it's about mission. But really, the main idea, that the driving force of what I think John is trying to communicate to us is this. True disciples of Jesus abide in an intimate, life-giving, fruit-producing relationship with Jesus. Period. Okay? Not comma, if, or then, period. That's what the passage that we're covering today is telling us. And again, it's building off of what we've been covering, right? The last several weeks and ultimately all through the Gospel of John. Luke said something today or just a few minutes ago as we were talking that John has almost a philosophical flavor to it. The Apostle John was a brilliant, brilliant guy. And some of the stuff and some of the themes that run all the way through the Gospel of John, we can read it hundreds of times and miss them. And yet when we see them, they're so obvious. So we have a brilliant man who's also being driven and inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this piece that we are working our way through, this book that we are working our way through. The other cool thing about this passage is that there's not a single person that it doesn't challenge. Okay? Everybody in the room gets punched in the throat tonight. That's just the way it works. That's just the way this passage works. It challenges the legalists, right? Those of us who like to have our boxes and our rules, and if you step outside of those boxes and those rules, then, you know, you're on the outside. It challenges the legalists because it tells us that Christianity is not about your performance. And some of us in the room we don't explicitly believe that Christianity is about our performance, but if we're going to drift in a direction, that's the direction we're going to drift, right? If we're going to find ourselves in a ditch, that's the ditch that we end up waking up in, right? Those are the legalists. It's not about your performance, but it's about knowing and walking with Jesus. It challenges the spiritualist. Okay? Now, these are terms that we don't often use, so they're they might sound weird, but the spiritualist is the one that thinks, you know, it's just about me and Jesus, and I just want to experience him in worship. And if I experience him in worship, and if I have a good experience in worship, and everything's floating and everything's wonderful, right? How does it challenge the spiritualists? Well, because this text tells us explicitly that true communion with God leads to a transformed and active lifestyle and produces fruit. And so again, it's not that we explicitly believe that that's not true, but for some of us, that's the ditch that we find ourselves in, right? That's the drift that we take. And then it also challenges those of us that, let's be perfectly honest, take all of this for granted. Grace becomes cheap. We like to excuse away our sin, ignore our sin, because you know what? Jesus died for me. No, we don't need to talk about that. Jesus died for me. I don't need to address that thing. I'm living in grace, man. And we give ourselves over and are never challenged in our sin because we don't want to look at it. How are those people challenged in this verse? Well, this passage has some warnings, doesn't it? God is a righteous judge, but it also has hope. Jesus is a life-giving Savior. So the three types of people that I just mentioned, everybody in this room fits one of those categories. Now, I'm not, you're like, oh, you can't put me in a box. I'm not trying to put anybody in a box. I'm just saying, as Christians, we all tend to drift in those ways. And this passage challenges each one of those areas of drift. So we're going to divide this passage into two parts. The first part is just the metaphor, okay? The metaphor is the vine, the branches, and the vine dresser. Now, it's pretty explicit. The metaphor is pretty explicit, right? It's not this like really weird abstract thing that we have to figure out. He kind of explains it. So that's part one we're going to talk about. And then part two is just the idea of abiding and bearing fruit. Okay, we're going to separate it in that way. So here we go. Vine and the branches, verse 1 through 8. Three parts of the metaphor. Again, vine, vine dresser, and branches. And we'll take them each in turn, starting with the vine. Verse 1, I am the true vine. This is Jesus talking. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Again, no like ambiguity there. He says, I'm the vine, my Father is the vine dresser. So Jesus is the vine. God the Father is the vine dresser. Very clear. Now, what's the significance of that? This is a really, really important part of the passage that drives everything else that we will read, okay? This is the last, and this is not by accident. Again, we're talking about the Gospel of John and John putting things and writing things in an order to make a point. This is something we talked about early and often in the earlier parts of John, is that John's not written chronologically. Okay, it doesn't start with the birth and then move forward timestamps to the death and the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus. John doesn't write his gospel that way. He writes it in such a way to make the points that he wants to make. This statement, I am the true vine, is the last of the seven I am statements made by Jesus. In the Gospel of John, Jesus makes seven I am statements, each one claiming to be God in a way that the Jewish people would understand according to the Old Testament scriptures. So here they are. I am the bread of life, he says in John chapter 6. I am the light of the world in John chapter 8. In John chapter 10, he says, I am the gate. And again in John chapter 10. In chapter 10 again, he says, I am the good shepherd. In chapter 11, he says, I'm the resurrection and the life. In chapter 14, he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And here he says, I am the true vine. Now, by saying I'm the true vine, Jesus is not just identifying with the God of Israel, but with Israel itself. That's the significant part of that statement, right? All through the Old Testament, well, not all through, but at several key points in the Old Testament, Israel, the nation, is referred to as God's vine. And so Jesus, speaking to Jewish men, saying that I am the true vine, they would have known what he was referring to. It was a massive, massive statement. Here's one of those passages in the Old Testament in the book of Hosea. Chapter 10, starting in verse 1, it says, Israel is a luxurious vine that yields its fruit. The more his fruit increased, the more altars he built. As his country improved, he improved his pillars. Their heart is false. Now they must bear their guilt. The Lord will break down their altars and destroy their pillars. So we know the story of Israel. They were set up to be the shining city on the hill. They were the people of God to communicate to the nations the goodness of God, the glory of God, as they lived according to God's standards. And as they communed with God, they would be this light to the nations. How'd they do? Not great, right? Not even middling. It was a massive faceplant. A massive failure again and again and again and again. In many ways, it's just repetitive failure all the way through the Old Testament, which is part of the purpose of the Old Testament, to show us what happens when we depend on ourselves to try to get close to God, to try to keep God's standards. And so Jesus isn't just saying, I am the vine. He says, I am the true vine. And in many ways, these passages in the Old Testament are prophetically speaking and looking towards Jesus. Jesus is the vine that the nation of Israel could not be. Jesus is the light to the nations that Israel could not be. He is doing what they could not. And so here's the application, right? He does the same for us. He does the same for us. God's plan for salvation for the whole world centers on Jesus. He is the true vine. This is why we read the Bible the way that we do. This is why we preach the gospel that we do, because Jesus is the true vine. We don't point people to the nation of Israel to find their salvation in the same way that we don't point them to ourselves to find their salvation. We point them to Jesus. Number two, the vine dresser. Again in verse 1, he says, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. The Father is the one that tends to the vine. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. So here's what we know. Regardless of what state a branch is in, God's main concern is to help the branches attain their maximum fruitfulness. Okay, that's what we see from the vine dresser. He says so explicitly in verse 8. He says, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. We talked about this idea last week, right? We talked about this idea of obedience in terms of created purpose, not just following guidelines. Yes, we're following guidelines, but it's our obedience as Christians is much bigger than that. And we talked about our chief purpose is to glorify God and to enjoy him, to be in relationship with him. That is our chief created purpose. So when we read this verse 8, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and prove to be my disciples. Our bearing fruit is part of our created purpose. You see that? Okay, we're building off of what we talked about last week and the week before and the week before and the week before. The vine dresser's goal is to see the vine and thus the branches bear fruit. It's multiplication. That's God's goal for your life. Right? This is us as a community, and it's you as an individual. When he's talking about the branches, he's talking about people. You, me. Which is the third part of the metaphor, right? Now, verses 2 through 8 tell us that those claiming to be disciples of Jesus are the branches. Okay? Very clear, that's what it says. There's two kinds of branches. Okay, this helps sometimes if we break this down to make it simple. There's two kinds of branches. Only two. Those that bear fruit and those that do not. Two kinds of branches. Verse 2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. If we take them in reverse order, okay? The branches that bear fruit, what does he do? He prunes. Now, we've been talking about this. I'm not a big-time arborist, so I don't know. Does anybody know the proper time to prune? Jay? Depends on what you're pruning. Okay, fair enough. So, like, the weather's been nice, and so Shannon and I have been talking about some pruning that needs to take place at our house, right? We cut things back to make them more healthy, okay? We cut away things that maybe would cause unhealth in order to bring greater health, greater fruitfulness. And one of the things that we have to understand as Christians is that God is not done with us. He's not done with you. He's pruning. He's continually pruning. Sometimes there are seasons of pruning, and it, just like in creation, there are different times and seasons for pruning. And as humans, we experience times and seasons of pruning. This is what the second half of Hebrews chapter 4 is all about. I want to read this to you, and I want to read it to you in a little bit different translation. I'm going to read it in the Message, okay? Because I want you to see maybe a little bit different flavor the writer of Hebrews is saying. In this all-out match against sin, others have suffered far worse than you, to say nothing of what Jesus went through, all that bloodshed. So don't feel sorry for yourselves. Or have you forgotten how good parents treat children and that God regards you as children? My dear child, don't shrug off God's discipline, but don't be crushed by it either. It's the child he loves that he disciplines. The child he embraces, he also corrects. God is educating you. That's why you must never drop out. He's treating you as dear children. This trouble you're in isn't punishment, it's training. The normal experience of children. Only irresponsible parents leave children to fend for themselves. Would you prefer an irresponsible God? We respect our own parents for training and not spoiling us, so why not embrace God's training so that we can truly live? While we were children, our parents did what seemed best to them, but God is doing what is best for us, training us to live God's holy best. At the time, discipline isn't much fun. It always feels like it's going against the grain. Later, of course, it pays off big time, for it's the well-trained who find themselves mature in their relationship with God. God's pruning his branches. Continually pruning his branches because he loves them. Because they are his children. So the encouragement here for us as children is not that we should be flippant about the pruning of God. Because often his pruning is devastatingly painful. It is difficult in every possible way. Physically, spiritually, emotionally, mentally. The purpose here is not to take it lightly. The purpose here is to understand that it's not punishment, and that he loves you. There's a purpose in it, and he will bring you through it. Why? Because you're attached to the vine, and his life is flowing in and through you, and because the pruning that you're undergoing right now will yield fruit. Do not despise the pruning of the Lord. Branch number one. Now there's another kind of branch, the one that does not bear fruit, and it says that this one is taken away by the vine dresser. Okay, verse 6 kind of adds to this. It says, if anyone does not abide in me, he's thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. Now, what does this mean? Does this mean that if a Christian, a branch, isn't doing good enough, isn't obeying good enough, isn't keeping the rules, has too many failures, backslides too many times, whatever, however you want to say it, is this verse saying that that Christian is going to get snapped off of the vine and thrown in the fire and judged? No. This is where a metaphor is a metaphor. And this is where the beauty of looking at the Gospel of John as one big story helps us. It helps us. Here's what I'm going to tell you, okay? over the years, I've preached this passage a couple times. And if you remember, there's been, as I've preached this passage, I've struggled with interpreting chapter or verse 2. Because there's two different interpretations, all right? There's one interpretation that simply says that, that these branches that do not bear fruit, we have true believers who bear fruit, and we have false believers who do not bear fruit. Therefore, they are not believers at all, by appearance only. And a few years ago, I was reading about the second interpretation of this verse that says there is a way, when in verse 2, when he says, where am I at? Verse 2 here. Oh, here we go. Verse 2, when he says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. There is a possible way to translate that phrase that we translate, takes away. There is a way to translate that to say, lifts up. So then it would read, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he lifts up. And then the metaphor, according to horticulture, would be that those vines are lifted up, reintroduced to the vine, tied up, cleaned, all of those things. And I've struggled going back and forth between the two interpretations because while verse 2 and verse 6 kind of go together, there seems to be some distinctions between verse 2 and verse 6. I'm sorry, I don't want to get too technical, but here's what's happened to me. As we have gone through the Gospel of John, and John repeatedly has talked about people that came to Jesus, saw a miracle that he did, and what does it say they did? They believed in him. And then we immediately cut to the next scene where those same people are doing what? Demanding that he be killed, saying that he has a demon, or just simply walking away. And so I've come to the conclusion, and you can come to your own conclusion, I've come to the conclusion that interpretation number 2 is not the correct interpretation because it doesn't fit the message of John. John is telling us quite clearly what it looks like to be a disciple of Jesus. Let's just go back one chapter. He's in the upper room having dinner with his disciples, and one of them does what? He says, one of you is going to betray me. One of you appears to be a branch. Has walked with me for 3 years, listened to my teaching, affirmed my identity again and again and again and again and again. But when it comes time, you are going to betray me. And we talked about the difference between Peter's denial of Jesus and Judas's betrayal of Jesus. We see this constantly through the book of John. People who claim to be believers, who might even look like believers on the outside, who are not connected to the vine, who are producing no fruit, and it says that the vine dresser will take them away, cut them off, throw them away, and they will be burned because they are not disciples of Jesus. And so here's the part in our world where we go, that seems kind of harsh, doesn't it? Right? That's the message that we get from the world when we say these kinds of things. But here we are. Here we are in the Gospel of John. And as Jesus is saying these words, he's continually inviting them to do what? Abide in me. That invitation is to those branches as well, as Jesus, all throughout the Gospel of John, has continually invited the multitudes, the crowds, the Pharisees even. Right? We talked about his commandments last week that we're supposed to obey. Abide in me, believe in me, believe in God, receive me, abide in me. So this is not a harsh God who says, if you don't do what I say, I'm going to get rid of you. This is a God that is continually inviting us into, yes, there are lines. We are continually invited into that relationship. that exclusive relationship. Yes, Christianity is extremely exclusive. There is only one way. Jesus claimed to be it. But in his exclusivity, he is continually inviting us. He says, come, abide. Who? Anyone who's weary. Take my yoke upon you, for I am gentle and lowly of heart. He's inviting, 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 inviting. And those that refuse to abide in him, who reject his continual invitations and say, no, I've got this, are the ones who are taken away. I think verse 3 is also very telling. What does he say in verse 3? He looks at his disciples after giving them this metaphor and says, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Again, building off of what we've already heard. When's the last time Jesus said those words? Not too long ago, as he washed the disciples' feet. Right? He's assuring them, you're clean. You are clean because of what I've done. Not because of what you have done. So here's the mistake that we make when we read passages like this. We talked about this last week when we talked about obedience. We can't mistake fruit-bearing for salvation. You see? We cannot say, I didn't bear any fruit last week. I'm not a Christian. That's not what he's saying here. That's not what he's saying here. He's not commanding them to bear fruit at all. That's not the commandment. What's the command? Abide in me. Abide in me. And that's our refusal. We find it easier to try to white knuckle bearing fruit than to abide in Jesus. Why is that? Like as humans, we are continually pulled towards self-reliance. Right? You see it in your kids. And you're like, here, help me tie your shoes. Get away from me. Right? Anybody? Dads, moms. Nobody taught them to do that. Nobody said, no, I'm going to try to help you. I want you to push me away so that you can learn how to tie your own shoes. They just do it. We pull towards self-reliance. Just like in the garden. Right? Wasn't that the lie that the serpent told Eve? God's lying to you. There's this whole other world. There's all this power. There's all this knowledge that you can have if you'll simply disobey, if you'll simply rely on yourself. And the invitation is to abide. We bear fruit because of his saving grace, not to try to earn it or to secure it. When he said to the disciples, you're clean, why were they clean? Because of what he did, because of his words that he spoke to them. We look at Christ, not ourselves. If we were to look at Hebrews chapter 12 again and go back to the beginning of the book, isn't this what it says? Where are we supposed to fix our eyes? On Jesus, who is what? The author, he wrote your salvation, and the perfecter of your faith. Fix your eyes on Jesus, not on ourselves. We don't try to bear fruit, we abide in him. Why? Because that's what he told us to do. That's what he invited us to do. What should branches do? What's the role of the disciple? First and foremost, abide in Jesus. Union with Christ is the foundation of communion with Christ. Right? Think about that in terms of a branch being connected to the vine. That's the union. If we're going to abide with Christ, we have to be connected with Christ. If we're not connected with Christ, we cannot abide with Christ. Verse 4, abide in me, and I in you. Remain. That's what the word abide means. Remain. Stay. Put down roots. Set up shop. Get comfortable. Hold on and don't let go sometimes, right? Abide. Remain. Steadfastness. Eugene Peterson calls a life of holiness long obedience in the same direction. So simple. Yet so, so difficult. Long obedience in the same direction. Remain. We are invited and commanded to abide. Knowing God, walking with Jesus. Knowing God, walking with Jesus, that's what he wants from you. Why? There are two reasons, okay? Number one, again, we talked about this last week. It's our created purpose. That's what we were created to do. We were created for a relationship with him. We are created to abide in him. And second of all, we can't produce fruit on our own. We abide in Jesus for the purpose of producing fruit. This is what 4 through 7 says. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Now skip to verse 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Now, we read verse 7 and then we go pray really hard and ask for something that we want. It doesn't happen. We'll say, well, I mean, you can't really believe the scriptures, right? But read it. Like, what's he trying to say? In verse 5, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, it is he that does what? Bears much fruit. Jesus said in our passage yesterday that you're going to do greater works than I ever did. And here he says, if you abide in me, you'll bear much fruit. And then in verse 7, he says, if you abide in me, my words abide in you. Ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. The context for asking for and receiving what we wish is clearly in the realm of bearing fruit. And clearly in our abiding in him and the life that is flowing through us on account of him brings things about that would not be possible otherwise. If we stay connected to the vine, if we are abiding in him, in his love. Verse 8, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. So there we were. That's our main idea, right? That true disciples of Jesus abide in an intimate, life-giving, fruit-producing relationship with Jesus. Period. Period. So we said we were going to divide this into two parts, the metaphor and then abiding in its fruits. Okay? Here we go. Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So there's a parallel there between the Father and the Son and us. You see it? Here's what this does not mean. Again, we have to see it. Here's what this does not mean. It does not mean that we keep his love by obedience. And if we are not obedient, that we lose his love. He's waiting to take it away from us. That's not what he's saying. Rather, we experience the fullness of his love because our disobedience is not clouding it. We're fixing our eyes on Jesus, and when we fix our eyes on Jesus, we experience the fullness of his love, and we turn in our disobedience and fix our eyes on other things, sometimes even ourselves. He's inviting them to abide. Verse 11, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is not a killjoy. This is not a killjoy God who wants you to follow rules and be miserable because that's the right thing to do. This is a God that's inviting us into the fullness of joy. It's a God who's claiming to know and claiming to have that fullness of joy to give. So that's the decision that we have to make, right? Do we believe him? Do we believe him that he has the fullness of joy? Do we believe him that his pruning is for our good and for his glory? If we do, then we will abide. We will remain. And if we don't believe him, we won't. We might say that we believe him because all of our friends do. Right? I was watching, what was that show called that we watched, James? Brain Teaser? Brain Games. We watched this fun little show called Brain Games, and they were doing experiments on peer pressure. There's this doctor's office, and this lady walks in. She has an appointment. She doesn't realize she's part of an experiment. She walks in, talks to the receptionist, sits down, and everybody else in the waiting room's in on it, right? So a buzzer goes off through the speaker, and everybody else that's in the waiting room stands up and then sits back down. And the third time it happens, she kind of looks around like, that's weird. And then it happens again and again and again and again. And you know what she does? She stands up and she sits back down. And then one by one, all the other people in the room are called into the doctor's office. And she's alone. The buzzer sounds. What does she do? She stands up. And then they asked her later on, why'd you do it? Because everybody else was doing it. So it seemed right. Okay, now you can apply this all kinds of ways to our culture today, can't you? Right? And I'm not just talking about COVID. All kinds of ways. Here's the point. Here's what John is telling us. There are people who've grown up in the church, who remain in the church, who play the game, who have never stopped to take stock of what they are truly doing and what they truly believe. And at some point in their life, they're going to experience something that's going to cause them to make that choice. And they're either going to remain or they're going to leave. They're going to accept Jesus. They're going to believe in him. They're going to abide in him. Or at some point, they're going to decide, it's not worth it. I can find greater joy somewhere else. I can find security somewhere else. I can do this on my own. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Verse 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. He's inviting them into relationship. You see that? Relationship with him and relationship with the Father. These things, verse 17, I command you so that you will love one another. Okay, the context for this loving one another is what? It's us. It's the church. You and me. Christians. Okay, it's the church, the local church, and the universal church. Believers, you are commanded, we are commanded to love one another. Why? Okay, that's fruit. Loving one another is the fruit. How do we do it? Because he loved us. Our obedience, our fruit flows out of the life and the grace and the love that he gives to us. Only. Only. The only way that we can forgive is if we are forgiven. The only way that we can truly love is if we have been loved first. Verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should abide. Your fruit will remain. It won't be burned up. It won't rot. It won't wither. It will stay. Namely, loving other people, making disciples. So that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. You received grace so that you can proclaim grace. You received life so that you can give life. It doesn't terminate with us, right? The branch is pruned so that it can do what? Bear fruit. Not so that it can be awesome, so that it can bear fruit. See, we lose the point of holiness, don't we? We miss it. We want to be holy so that we can gain approval from God, or that we can gain approval from others. And we want to be good Christians. The point of holiness, the point of abiding, is so that we can bear fruit. It's loving others. So we fix our eyes on him, not on ourselves. Abiding in the power of Christ involves the word and prayer. Two times he mentions asking things of the Father. You see that? Two times. He's inviting us to abide with him. And as humans, as people on this physical earth who are waiting for Jesus to return and be physically with us and abide with us for eternity, we talked about this last week, have received the Holy Spirit and can abide with Christ through the Holy Spirit, and he's given us a few ways, not limited to the word and prayer, but mainly the way that we abide with him is through these ways, through the word and through prayer. He commands us, invites us, and commands us to ask the Father, to pray. This is the power of the Spirit. Abide, 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 abide. I can't say it enough. We have been invited and commanded to move deeper into his love, deeper into his grace, to find more joy, more fulfillment. See, this isn't an aimless life where we just, sing songs that we kind of think are weird all day, every day, and exist in this kind of butterfly fairy world of happiness while the world falls apart around us. That's not what he's describing. He's describing real gritty life. He's describing joy in the midst of pain. He's describing hope that we can't find anywhere else. He's describing purpose in the midst of a world that seems to be headed towards disaster, no matter which way you look. This is what he's giving us. This is what he's offering us. And the invitation and the command is quite simply to abide. So here's the application. Here's the challenge. How are we doing it? Or are we? Right? Not simply as action that we are commanded to do, but think about this. How are you existing in relationship with him? Okay? Not how many days did you miss last week in your Bible reading? Right? Did you go to the prayer meeting? Did you do this? Did you do that? That's not what I'm saying. It's not what I'm saying. How did you exist in your created purpose this week? How did you do at allowing the love and the grace of Jesus to flow into you and out of you? How did you respond in that conversation when you had the opportunity to show patience or love? How did you do in that conversation when you had the opportunity to receive love? These are the flags that tell us how we're doing. Have we fixed our eyes on Jesus? or are they wandering to and fro? Right? Sometimes the love of Jesus challenges us a little bit deeper than we want to be challenged. I'm going to close with this. Don't run from the challenge. Don't run from the challenge. Move towards it. Because the challenge is an invitation. Abide. Abide, abide, abide. Abide in him and exist in community with each other. One of the ways that we as a church abide is by continually reminding ourselves, as he commanded us to, of what he did for us. If you have your communion, if you would take that. If you would take out the bread, if you want to call that bread. The last night that Jesus was with his disciples as they ate, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said to them, "This is my body that is broken for you. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." He then took the cup and he passed it around to them. And he said, "This is my blood that is poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your command. Thank you for your invitation. You call to us daily, Lord, daily. Minute by minute, hour by hour, to abide in you. Lord Jesus, give us ears to hear your voice. Give us ears to hear your spirit. Lord, fill us with your assurance that if we abide in you, we are clean. Nothing to earn, nothing to prove. Father, if we feel devoid of that life, may we respond to your invitation. May we find that union. May we re-find that union. And may we commune with you. Help us to abide, Lord. We love you. Amen.
For my waking breath, for my daily bread, I depend on you, and I depend on you for the sun to rise, for my sleep at night. I depend on you, I depend on you. You're the way and the truth and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Would you stand with us and sing? Where the Spirit leads, as I'm following, I depend on you, I depend on you for the victories still in front of me. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way and the truth and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. As through death as I enter rest, I depend on you. I depend on you. For eternal life to be raised in Christ. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way and the truth and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength and my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide.
God, we ask you to teach us to abide tonight. Teach us to wait on you, to put our hope in you, not to give up when the times get hard. Like between songs, time's hard.
It is the name of Jesus. could not hold you, fell tall before you. You silenced the boast of sin and shame. Heavens are roaring, praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Filled with kindness and compassion for the one for whom you gave your son for humanity. Increase my love, so help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Know that when they look in my eyes, they would see you. Even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's love. Oh, how you love us. From the homeless to the famous and in between. You formed us and you made us carefully. 'Cause in the end, we're all your children. So help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Know that when they look in my eyes, they would see you. Even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's love. Let all my life tell of who you are and the wonders of your never-ending love. Oh, let all my life tell of who you are, that you're wonderful, such a good Father. Oh, let all my life tell of who you are and the wonders of your never-ending love. Let all my life tell of who you are, such a wonderful and such a good Father. You are wonderful and such a good Father. So help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. Though that when they look in my eyes, they would see you. even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's love. So help me to love with open arms like you do. A love that erases all the lines and sees the truth. And though that when they look in my eyes, they would see you, even in just a smile, they would feel the Father's love.
God, we ask you to be with us. Draw us into your presence, that out of us would come beautiful fruit. That it would come by way of nature, that it would come naturally. That no tree is straining to flower in the spring or to turn into fruit, but your miracle of life would come out of us, right in the place where you've placed us. In Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. The ushers are going to come by. We invite you to put your prayer requests on there. stand with us and sing the doxology?
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus go with you now and always. You're dismissed.